talk about this movie a bit. If you are one of the 1% of people who are actually awake here, then you will see with your eye that this movie is a way to program you. Basically, the plot of this is the end of the world. It goes through three phases. One is disrupting communication and everyone not knowing what's going on. Two is disorder and confusion, people not knowing what is happening. And then three is civil war. Throughout the plot of this, technology is going down and basically everyone is going into chaos. Planes are flying out of the sky, boats are riding up on land. You got deer acting weird AF because that's what animals do. They can sense supernatural things and things that we cannot see. But if you know anything about Hollywood and the media and one of our very kind ex-presidents who did so much for this country, you'll know that this is all predictive programming. Hence the word programming following the word TV that tells you a vision. There's a book by Ray Dalio, it's called The Changing World Order. It talks about the rise and fall of nations. And the US, it's currently around here. Large debts, printing money, internal conflict. You see all the social things going on. What follows is loss of reserve currency, weak leadership, civil war. Meanwhile, you got these morally superior gentlemen uniting in one single currency, basically to get rid of the US dollar. It's called BRICS. And so if you see what's going on here, by doing this and opening this, you can feel that something weird is happening. And basically what this movie is a way to make you accept a new reality. Because what we perceive with our eyes and our eye is truth becomes our reality. We realize it. It comes into realization. So why am I spreading this message if we don't need to bring it into our reality? One thing you need to realize is you literally have nothing to fear other than fear itself, which is an illusion. And so by you watching this, by you becoming aware of it, you are doing one of the most important, if not the most important thing you can do while you're alive, which is elevate your consciousness. And when you are aware of a negative, you can consciously choose the positive. Because what you're unaware of will constantly affect you. You are the cause, not the effect. And so if you watch this movie, and if you're someone who hasn't, I know right now your curiosity is sparked and you want to, go into it and I challenge you to watch it from a place of awareness and not letting the emotion affect you. You can watch it, but you don't have to accept it. Your brain is constantly recording this stuff. So while you watch the movie, imagine every single scene as the opposite. Do not accept fear into your life. Love through fear. Fear has a nature of its own. I've literally died and witnessed absolute fear and terror in front of me and consuming me. And the only way to beat it is to turn into absolute love and go through it. Never avoid it. Acknowledge that it's there. And as soon as you can accept it, you can move through it and it disappears. You fight back by remaining firm in your truth, in the truth. You do not give in to an opposing force of negativity and fear that wants to lower your vibration and your frequency. You have a choice to either live down here in fear or up here in love, joy, peace, and enlightenment. But remember, it's a choice. And you don't have to be religious, but look at Christ, for example. Jesus was the embodiment of dying to the fear and still conquering it. That's what the whole message is. You overcome fear by loving through it with courage. You put yourself on the cross, you disintegrate who you were, and then you step into the new version of yourself that can live fearlessly while still feeling that fear. Remind yourself that fear is the ultimate compass to where you need to go, and it's all within. Every time you experience fear, it is calling you to go in that direction, embodying love, accepting its nature, and conquering it in the name of truth. In the end, God will win. It's already been won.
So y'all, I was cooking dinner, and I have Leave the World Behind on in the living room because, you know, ADHD, and I need some noise. And I just so happened to look out here when this map flashed on the screen, and I thought, oh, you know what? Let me check to see how Columbus, Ohio does when this happens. And we're right here, friends, right there. And that is low on the map. But what's this? And why won't my phone pick it up?
Americans are panicking over these deer videos that have gone viral yesterday across places in the United States, including New York and Mount Rushmore. The reason is because of the recent movie Leave the World Behind on Netflix, produced by former President Barack Obama and Michelle Obama. And in case you haven't seen it, it's about how the U.S. gets occupied and shut down completely by the whole world, where other countries around the world shut down all our satellites, communication systems, send radio frequency microwave weapons, and eventually attack the cities. Coming a day after the U.S. deciding to veto the ceasefire request in Palestine, where other countries of the world are demanding an immediate ceasefire. But the U.S. denied that. Many countries are now thinking of how to make it happen. But what's the deal with these deer videos? These videos are CGI and are not real. But what do you think about this? Is the U.S. pissing off other countries by their international intervention supporting Israel and Ukraine? And have you seen the movie, and what do you think about former President Obama producing the movie?
You see, that's why I don't fuck with Tesla cars, and I don't even much fucking drive. Like, the fact that they're tripping during this whole cyber attack apocalypse is where you got me fucked up. Like, imagine running for your life, and then all of a sudden you got all these Tesla cars just running you the fuck over.
There's nobody here.
Brand new.
What? Whoa, hey, someone's coming. Go!
See, bitch, hail to the no.
Y'all seen all the hype going around about this Leave the World Behind movie? It's all over my For You page. Everybody and their mom is talking about it. Because apparently the Obamas were executive producers of this movie. And a lot of people have found really weird Easter eggs, including a QR code that is hidden in the map. This QR code. And if you scan this sneaky little hidden QR code, it will take you to this website, visitmercercounty.com, and it opens up this page about the Lake Shawnee Abandoned Amusement Park. So what in the world could that mean? Well, I don't know, but this sounds like a place right up my alley. So let's head on over to West Virginia and see what we can find out about this Lake Shawnee Abandoned Amusement Park. So it turns out that the land where this abandoned amusement park was built has a very long and bloody history. Back in 1775, the Clay family had settled here. One afternoon in August of 1783, Mitchell Clay went hunting, and he had two of his sons, Bartley and Ezekiel, building a fence. And his oldest daughter, Tabitha, was down by the river washing the family clothes with some of the smaller girls. I think there were like 13 kids in this family. Well, as the children were going about their chores, a band of 11 Shawnee men crept up on them. They shot Bartley, killing him instantly. Hearing the shot, his sister Tabitha came running. She ran towards Bartley as all the smaller girls ran into the cabin where their mother was. And apparently Tabitha was a very brave girl because she started wrestling with one, trying to defend her fallen brother Bartley. It's said that she was cut to pieces before she was killed, and both Bartley and Tabitha were scalped. The 16-year-old Ezekiel was captured and taken prisoner. The mother, Phoebe, had gathered up all the smaller children and run for the closest neighbor, which was 6 miles away. 6 miles on foot with a bunch of kids in tow, it took them a minute to get there. During this time, Mitchell Clay returned. He found the bodies of his two butchered children and the rest of the family gone, and he assumed they had all been killed. He raced into town, gathered a group of men to pursue them. A battle ensued when he caught up with them, but some of the Shawnee warriors were able to get away with Ezekiel still in tow. He was taken to a settlement in Ohio where he was burned at the stake. Eventually, his body was retrieved. Some sources say that all three of the Mitchell children were buried on the property. Others say it's just Mrs. Bartley and Tabitha. The place where their homestead sat remained empty until 1923, when it was purchased by a businessman who decided to build an amusement park. The park opened in 1926. It had a Ferris wheel and a swing, the lake to swim in, it had a swimming pool, concession stands, and a dance hall and cabins to stay overnight. And it was a hit. It was very popular with the people of Mercer County. Until the 1950s, when children began to die there. It said there were at least 6 deaths while it was open. The first was an 11-year-old boy who drowned in the pool when his arm got stuck in a drain pipe. Then a little girl, roughly the ages of 10 to 12, was killed on the swings when a delivery driver backed up into her. Another boy drowned in the lake, and a 3-year-old girl was crushed by a lift. That's 4 of them. I don't know the circumstances of the other two. The park was eventually closed in 1966 due to a failed inspection, and it sat abandoned for 20 years until another businessman came along in 1985. And wanted to reopen the amusement park. But it wasn't open very long before it closed again in 1988 because of rising insurance costs. Then in the 90s, he started digging around because he was going to build something else. Some say a neighborhood, some say some kind of racetrack. It was discovered that the park sat on top of an ancient burial ground. An excavation was done by a team from Marshall University who found many artifacts of the Shawnee people, along with mass graves that held up to 3,000 burials. That's a big burial ground. They also discovered that at one point, the park had been a settlement. It had been set up in some kind of circular pattern and had been occupied for quite a long time before it was abandoned. There's no clues as to why everyone left. It's believed that it was empty for several hundred years before settlers arrived. But once this was discovered, the owner decided that he should just let the remains rest, and all construction plans were canceled, which was smart. Some people believe that the land is cursed. Others believe it was the Clay family who brought on a curse by desecrating the burial ground. But either way, this place is considered very haunted and very paranormally active. And it's been featured on several TV shows and documentaries. It's been called one of the most terrifying places in America and one of the 10 most haunted places in the world. Many people have seen the spirit of a little girl sitting on the swing. Shadowy silhouettes have been seen in the cars of the Ferris wheel. And the spirits will actually touch people, like tap them on the shoulder. There's disembodied voices and the ghostly laughter of children. Other people have reported hearing the sounds of drums and distant chanting. And I can't lie, there's something about this place that gives me these super creeps. I kind of freaked out a little when I first pulled this place up and was looking at it, because I'm pretty sure I've dreamed of this place before, which is super creepy. I have no idea what that means. But anyways, this is private property, but tours are offered. And in October, they host a dark carnival in the park. While this is all very creepy and interesting, I still have no idea what any of that has to do with this. I watched it and I have no clue what the connection could be. Please tell me what y'all think. Why would a QR code and Leave the World Behind take us to the Lake Shawnee Abandoned Amusement Park? Because that is pretty weird.
Here are hidden messages in the movie Leave the World Behind. Spoiler alert. First is the changing artwork. As you can see behind the bed, the waters are calm and still. But as it progresses, it becomes more turbulent. As you can see here, this symbolizes that still waters will be no more in the future to come. Next is this photo, which appears to be like radio waves or signals, that changes to this, and then eventually looks like this, reinforcing that our signals are going to be interrupted. Then we also have this artwork right here, which is eyes on a painting by a painter named Barthélemy Togo. The same artist also had an exhibition called Craving for Humanity, where his designs speak to the upheavals of the world, such as wars, famine, and abuse of powers. Next is this scene from above, which appears to look like a power button, signifying turn the power off. Next, we have this pamphlet, which translates into Death to America, and what appears to be of Islamic origin. To add to that, let's not forget that the author, Rumman Alam, is Islamic, and Mahershala Ali is also Islamic. And this was done cleverly to show who the message and warning is coming from. Lastly, I'll touch on what was seen while traveling. We see Fort Morse Road and Point Comfort, exit 76. Fort Morse was a free black settlement during slavery. This movie had a lot of references to race, which I would have to do a whole nother video for. So get in the comments if you want me to touch on that. Point Comfort was the irony of them actually leaving the city to come to the island to get out of their comfort zone, and how what's to come is going to also get them out their comfort zone. Exit 76 has to deal with the year the United States was established. The White Line, which also touches on the racial aspects of this movie, was a ship that brought the first African slaves to the colony of Virginia. We see the Huxleys, which is a reference to Aldous Huxley, the author of A Brave New World. And we also have the registration, which is 1222. Some speculate it's predicting a date. Others say it's nothing at all. I'll let you decide. I'll finish this off by explaining the ending, which most people hated. The little girl you just saw was obsessed with Friends and wanted to watch the last episode called The Last One. Not to mention that Matthew Perry used to date Julia Roberts, and he coincidentally passed away on her birthday. So basically, his ending marks her new beginning with this movie. And that is what the ending was all about. The end of the world as we know it, and a new one trying to survive. Once seen, it can't be unseen. And in the land of the blind, the one-eyed man is king.
Let's talk about this movie, Leave the World Behind. I mean, the title says enough, Leave the World Behind. Now, the first thing I noticed when I start watching this movie was how they kept showing the Rockstar logo. You feel me? We all know it's a new GTA coming out. All this stuff is symbolic. Pay attention to the beat headphones he got on. You feel me? They showing us how they distract us through this music, through these games. The driveway of the house they pulled into. And it gotta be some of these beats in this music, because tell me that this is not a beat right there. Y'all see that? And tell me there's not an AirPod with his yellow arrow at. Something about them beats. I don't know what it is. Which makes me wonder about this scene right here. Always remember to watch out for the checkerboard. It's always gonna be somewhere in the mix. I've been warning y'all about the blackout. I'm telling y'all, they put this stuff in movies. Y'all better pay attention. They show how the scrap that our kids be. You feel me? They'll never see the seriousness in real situations. You feel me? All this going on and what she worried about watching that show. I coincidental knowing what this movie about, she got on a NASA shirt. I'm telling you, all this stuff is symbolic. I remember when the radio had went in and out and it was talking about how the cyber attack was messing up the animal migration pattern. I remember when all the animals was acting weird, walking in circles and nobody know what was going on. That's the same thing. That's what was happening with these deer in the movie. Crazy how these movies be reflecting real life, huh? Y'all remember what they said this meant on that paper? Death to America. Now this dude say that Korea's behind all this, which is ironic because wasn't we just into it with North Korea? And we know this man knew what he was talking about in the movie because he was the only one that really had supplies at the end. Cut off all communication, cut off all transportation. This part right here though, this part right here was so surreal. This part right here gave me the chills. We then became too dependent of technology. You feel me? This new technology and stuff. Remember what he said? The truth is more scarier. And they literally told us everything in this movie. The whole time, these people looking for help, you feel me? They looking for a safe place. Talking about the daughter end up finding the rich people bunker. They keep showing us how the scrap of the kids be. Instead of her going to get her family and letting them know that she found the bunker, she decided to sit there and catch up on her show. What really get me is, these two helped produce this movie, how I run it. Already been talking about we ain't got no government, you feel me? So this really make me think, like, have we already been left behind or something? I mean, he did say no one is in control. No one is pulling the screens.
And I feel like this movie's a warning.
Let me tell you, I'm watching this movie right now. And this movie is telling us something. Right? That we're not supposed to know. Since it's a movie, it's fictional. This part. I'm gonna play it. Please pay attention.
Why I came here involves something that happened to me a few years back. One of my clients invited me and my wife to a private event. My client, I won't say his name, but you'd recognize it, though.
Is he a celebrity?
I don't know, nothing like that. But in the business world, he's one of the biggest out there. He deals mostly in defense contracting. I'm talking hush-hush, top-secret money from the Pentagon. Perhaps the most powerful person I've ever had a meal with. Anyway, we're at this soiree at his house. It's getting late. My wife, she wants to go. We and I are just having a blast. And he doesn't want the night to end. After a few more glares, my wife agrees to take a cab and I'll come home after.
Mm-hmm. I bet she was real happy about that.
Mm-hmm. So we're having a few more drinks, getting really sauced. And at one point, I don't think he could stand and I was pretty wildly myself.
I wouldn't know anything about that, sir.
So, he takes me to his study, smoke a few cigars, and we're sort of flying high, laughing at almost everything. Eventually, he starts in how much he likes me and how he wishes he could invite me on this trip he's about to go on.
What kind of trip? Where's he going?
That's exactly what I asked. Then he turns to me, a serious face, and he says, "Oh, you know, just my annual meeting with the rest of the evil cabal that runs the world." He was the kind of guy that was always known for jokes like that. Again, if I told you his name, you would understand.
Wow, I just have to take your word for it. And now, if you'll excuse me, I'm going to cop off my mouth.
And then, yesterday before the symphony, my friend calls me up. No scheduled appointment like he usually does, just calls me out of the blue. He wants me to move around some of his money. And we're talking some big numbers, even for him. And as we're getting off the phone, I ask if he wanted to grab a drink. He tells me he's going away for a while. I joke back to him. Well, yeah. You hanging with your evil cabal this weekend? Thought that was only during the winter solstice. And he doesn't laugh. And he always laughs, even with bad jokes. All he said was, "Take care of yourself." Almost as if he felt sorry for me. Ever since, I haven't been able to get it out of my head.
Are you thinking that your friend is somehow behind what's happening here?
No, nothing like that. The conspiracy theory about a shadowy group of people running the world is far too lazy of an explanation. Especially when the truth is much scarier.
What is the truth?
No one is in control. No one is pulling the strings. Sure, there are those like my friend who might have the right kind of access to the right kind of information. But when events like this happen in the world, the best even the most powerful people can hope for is a heads up.
Now, why are there bunkers? Why are there bunkers, bomb shelters all around the world? Why? Because they know before we do. They can't control it. You can't control it. But at least they know in advance so they can hide from it. And like us, we don't know what's going on. Just like them. This movie, man.
How much deeper does this weird rabbit hole have to be? Julia Roberts was born on October 28th. Matthew Perry died suspiciously on October 28th. What are the odds that this movie, Leave the World Behind, which is produced by Julia Roberts and the Obamas, which includes scenes from Friends, okay, considering the fact that she had a relationship with Matthew Perry, she was born on the same day that Matthew Perry died, and then what, several months later, this movie just so happens to come out, and all of the symbolism in this movie is so geared to programming, and you have a former president that's helping to produce this, and she dated Matthew Perry, and she's born on the same day Matthew Perry died. Do y'all think this shit is a coincidence? And the cause of his death is still undetermined. So they don't know if there was foul play within it, okay? Okay? When you start to see all the pieces of this really crazy rabbit hole, there's something really odd with this. I mean, the fact of the matter, in the middle of the movie, the children are wearing t-shirts, and when they're standing next to each other, it's telling you to obey a deceiver of all deceivers, okay? He dies on the same day she's born, and they had a relationship together, and they're both now referenced in this movie that both her and the Obamas made. The movie is surrounding the alert that they're sending out, White House and major cities under attack by rogue armed forces, elevated radiation levels detected near multiple population centers. Like, dude, this whole entire thing is some crazy ass thing right out of the Twilight Zone, okay? He dies on the same day she's born, they've been in a relationship, it's just Wow. What are your guys' thoughts on that? There's something behind this. There's a plot. There's something that's to become from this, because there's no way that all these things connect in these weird ass ways, and there's no meaning behind it other than it's just a movie. That's why they're programming you through that movie. And you didn't even, did any of y'all even see the beginning credits where it says that Barack and Michelle Obama are executive producers? Did you even know that? What are the odds of that? He did say that he wanted to be president behind the scenes. What better way than to reach out to the 240 million subscribers on Netflix, right? Come on. Really?
This movie felt like a warning. I'm so glad one of y'all said this. This movie felt like a warning because it was a warning. But at the same time, don't get it twisted. Keep this in mind, please. They're pushing a narrative, and we create the narrative for them. So yes, this is a possibility of what could happen. And yes, there is a high possibility of this happening. But at the same time, if something like this does happen, don't refer back to this movie and be like, oh, they made a movie about this, I know exactly what I need to do. No, because that'll be the trap. Instead, go with your inner instincts, not fear, and not this movie itself, or within this paradigm. Another thing is that Barack Obama was a part of this movie script. It says here, Barack and Michelle Obama produced Netflix's Leave the World Behind and helped with the script. It says here, Barack Obama was especially invested in the film, providing valuable and detailed notes on the script. Esmail revealed that he would ask the former president for advice when penning the original drafts, as it helped him root the story in reality. Me personally, I kind of think it's weird that a former president helped out with a movie that's kind of foreshadowing the future. So to say that there is definitely some truth in that movie. If a former president is helping you write the script, definitely some truth in that movie. But at the same time, I have to say this. They push a narrative and we create it for them. So if something like this does happen, don't think back to this movie and be like, I know exactly what I need to do. That's all I'm trying to say. Like, don't do that. Because I know I've made videos about this movie, and I don't want people getting the wrong idea, especially if I can articulate myself in a way that is beneficial and understandable. So yes, they made a movie about this. Yes, there is a little bit of possibility of this happening. Just be aware. But at the same time, they push narratives and we create the reality. Our experience and minds literally create this outside reality. So when they make movie of things like this, don't project or live in fear, because that's you literally creating that reality. I just had to say that and make that crystal clear. Now, besides that, I got some fire crystal jewelry, crystal bracelets, and crystal necklaces. Here go the necklaces right here. I made these today. You should definitely go check out my website, because you might see something on it that you really like. The link is in my bio. And yes, this is Goku, by the way. And I also got a Dragon Ball pendant too I'm about to do. But yeah, fire gear. The link is in my bio. Go check it out. You might see something on it that you really, really like. For real, for real. Check it out. I love y'all.
Analysis of military campaigns. There was one program in particular that terrified my client the most. A simple three-stage maneuver that could topple a country's government from within. The first stage was isolation. Disable their communication and transportation. Make the target as deaf, dumb, and paralyzed as possible. Setting them up for the second stage. Synchronized chaos. Terrorize them with covert attacks and misinformation. Overwhelming their defense capabilities, leaving their weapon systems vulnerable to extremists in their own military. Without a clear enemy or motive, people would start turning on each other. Done successfully, the third stage would happen on its own. What's the third stage? A coup d'etat. Civil war. Collapse. This program was considered the most cost-effective way to destabilize a country. Because if the target nation was dysfunctional enough, it would, in essence, do the work for you.